How will history remember the presidency of Barack Obama? On foreign policy and national security, will he be considered a success or a failure? A belligerent hawk or a cautious dove? On this Upfront special, I'll ask Derek Chollet, a former Pentagon and State Department official under Obama, and author of the book The Long Game, How Obama Defied Washington and Redefined America's Role in the World. I'll also speak to former presidential aide Reggie Love, who Obama described as his little brother, and ask him what the president was like in private, away from the cameras. Who is the real Barack Obama? Derek Chollet, thanks for joining me on Upfront. I spoke to a senior White House official not long ago who said, "You'll miss us when we're gone." How much do you think Obama will be missed? How much do you think he'll be remembered as a transformative president, someone who changed US foreign policy, America's role in the world for the better, versus how much he'll be remembered as a brief interlude, a footnote between the Bush and Trump eras?
Well, I think he will be missed, and I think as time goes on, there will be even greater appreciation here in the United States and around the world for many of President Obama's accomplishments in foreign policy, whether it's his approach to international institutions, his efforts to address climate change, his embrace of diplomacy to deal with threats like Iran's nuclear program. There are some many difficult parts of Obama's legacy that the next president will have to confront as well. I think many of those are more a testament to the difficulties of the problems themselves than any of Obama's policies. But this will be the test for history.
You have written that Obama is all about the long game. He is a president, quote, less concerned with appearances and the whims of the moment, with more of an eye to long-term success. What long-term success will he leave behind in Syria?
Well, it's very difficult to see. It's very difficult to see. I mean, what the U.S. has tried to do over the past several years is not solve the Syrian conflict. I think that's an illusion of our abilities to try to solve that conflict, but to try to mitigate the consequences, to try to contain it as best we can, to try to address what our direct security threats are within Syria, which is ISIL. So I think there's been some successes. There's been many failures. Those of us who were involved in the making of Syria policy in the last 5 years don't look with any pride upon what Syria is today. Some successes. I think 1,300 tons of chemical weapons out of Syria is good for the world, good for us.
But you know full well that there are plenty of people on both right and left who say Syria is not just a stain on the conscience of the world, it's a stain specifically on Obama's foreign policy record. They say he could have done more. He could have, for example, set up a no-fly zone to protect civilians, as your former boss, Hillary Clinton, who you campaigned for to be president, as she called for on multiple occasions.
There's many things we could have done, and the challenge for the United States when it comes to a problem like Syria, when it comes to a problem like Russia or China in the South China Sea, is usually not one of capability. The U.S. military can do many things. The question is, will it actually have the impact we want it to have, and what comes next? A no-fly zone, an issue that I studied very closely during my time at the Pentagon, certainly something the U.S. military is capable of doing. The U.S. military has been bombing Syria every day since September of 2014, hitting ISIL targets. But the question in the president's mind was, will a no-fly zone actually solve the problem we're trying to get at here in Syria?
Wouldn't have protected civilians?
He was not convinced. I don't think it would have. It would have helped some civilians, but just as a no-fly zone didn't protect civilians on the ground in Libya, we didn't have a no-fly zone in Libya. We ended up having a no-drive zone where we had to bomb ground targets, not just air targets. And we saw what happened there. And I think that lesson is also foremost in many of our minds when it comes to U.S. intervention in Syria, the Libya lesson.
So you have no regrets on not taking the extra steps your critics, specifically on the extra steps in terms of extra weapons to the rebels, a no-fly zone, bombing of Assad airports or jets, et cetera.
There are many things, as I've looked back, that the U.S. could have done differently.
What's the top one?
I think we clearly could have supported the Syrian opposition 6 months earlier than we actually did when this original debate started. That said, looking back, I can't say that that would have been the decisive difference in making the Syrian opposition stronger against Assad.
Your former colleague, Frederick Hoff, who was an Obama State Department advisor on Syria, has not only described Obama as a failed president because of Syria, but has claimed that the administration's policy towards Syria and Assad rests on its desire to accommodate Iran, basically to ensure that the Iran nuclear deal stays intact. Mm-hmm. He has a point, doesn't he? Why not just say out loud what everyone's thinking?
No, I totally disagree with that. I don't think there's any evidence of that, despite what former colleagues may assert. I think the president has had a very tough policy against Iran. It was because of the combination of economic and military pressure that Iran was brought to the table and came to a deal on limiting its nuclear program for the next 10 to 15 years. I don't see that in any way connected to any of the policy decisions on Syria. At least that's not my experience.
You've said that Obama's decision not to enforce his own self-imposed red line on chemical weapons use by Syria's government, his decision not to bomb Assad in 2013, and instead go for the inspections route, may have been, quote, inelegant or an ugly win, but the outcome made us all safer. That's not true, though, is it? It didn't make the people of East Aleppo safer. The UN has documented numerous instances of Assad in 2016 using chlorine gas against civilians and rebels, making a mockery of your disarmament deal, of the red line, of Obama. Of Obama's position.
Again, 1,300 tons of chemical weapons are out of Syria today. It wasn't an inspection regime, it was an elimination regime. It's true that Assad has terribly innovated the use of industrial chemicals like chlorine, which are banned as use to be used as weapons, but were not weaponized at the time. I mean, chlorine is readily available anywhere. And so that was not part of that deal. Now, I think when it came to the red line and responding to the red line, and I was someone who was in the Pentagon who was planning and advocating for the use of force to implement the red line, because we wanted to deter Assad from using chemical weapons and degrade his ability to use them further. We never imagined we could come to a deal to eliminate 1,300 tons of chemical weapons. So when that opportunity presented itself, we took it.
So as someone who was advocating airstrikes in private at the time, within the Pentagon.
And publicly with Capitol Hill, absolutely.
But looking back, you actually think, no, the deal was still a better option.
Well, absolutely.
Despite all the people who have died since, despite the use of chemical weapons.
That's a separate issue.
The Syrians on the ground would say it's not a separate issue.
In my view, the elimination of 1,300 tons of chemical weapons was the core U.S. national security interest. There's a separate issue about how we use military power to try to influence the dynamics of the Syrian civil war. That's a separate issue.
One particular policy that many would say has backfired, has undermined international law, undermined U.S. standing in the world, Obama's own standing in the world, and has maybe created a whole new generation of anti-American fighters, are drone strikes, which Obama ramped up way beyond anything George W. Bush authorized, with hundreds of civilians killed in places like Pakistan, Yemen, U.S. citizens killed via drone, and overall, many would say, not much to show for it in terms of a reduction in terrorism or terrorist groups, however you define them.
Well, that helps point up the paradox of Barack Obama, because to some critics, he's weak-kneed, unwilling to use force, doesn't believe in American power, you know, doesn't pull the trigger. To other critics, he's the guy who's bombed more countries than George W. Bush, who's presided over this global drone campaign and deployed special operations forces in all these countries and killed a lot of people along the way. So there is this paradox. Yep. He's hard to categorize often. No question that the use of drones has been one of the more controversial and difficult issues that President Obama's had to face. He's used them quite effectively, tried very hard, I think, to eliminate civilian casualties, understanding very well that the use of drones can often create terrorists in some ways because of your alienating and angering many, many people. He's also mindful you can't kill your way out of the terrorist problem. So I think there's been a lot of success in disrupting terrorist networks.
The former head of the CIA's Counterterrorism Center says drones are creating more enemies than we are removing from the battlefield. And a leaked CIA internal study found that drone strikes can, quote, increase support for insurgents, radicalize remaining leaders, and create a vacuum into which more radical groups can enter.
Sure, they can do that. I mean, that's one of the dilemmas.
You don't accept they have done that?
In some instances, they have, certainly. I mean, they're not a perfect tool. These are not perfect tools.
So why use it at something like nine times the rate of George W. Bush?
Because the tool is becoming more sophisticated. It's becoming more prevalent. It's more available.
But if it makes things worse on the ground.
But I'd say that on balance, it doesn't. I mean, I think on balance,
what's
it's
your
been
evidence
successful.
Saying on balance, it doesn't.
The terrorists taken off the battlefields, no question.
But if they're replaced the Afghan Taliban leader was taken off the battlefield by a drone, his replacement is more extreme.
Yeah,
well done.
I think actually on balance, this is a tool that Obama has used effectively. The question
I'm asking for the evidence.
For the next terrorists taken off the battlefield, leaders taken, there's no
even
question.
Even if experts are saying that the people who come along are worse,
can.
That it creates.
And again,
more.
I don't know the experts you're citing.
The former head of the CIA Counterterrorism Center.
Who? What era did he serve in? Who?
In the George W. Bush era, Robert Grenier.
There you go. So I don't know what experience he's got going over the Obama drone
program. Former head of the CIA Counterterrorism Center doesn't have an experience.
No, I'm just saying, I don't. I, you know, what's his opinion versus my opinion? I'm saying it worked. He's saying it didn't.
I'm asking for evidence. The CIA has done a study from 2009, which was leaked in 2014, which cites the ways in which it creates worse problems.
Yeah, I hadn't seen the study.
And many people in Yemen, in Pakistan, in the places where this happened, and are pointing this out.
Many, many people in the current CIA today who've been presiding over this very difficult program will say it's worked.
And I'm asking for the definition of worked. And all you're saying is taking people off the battlefield.
Absolutely.
Even though we see the number of terrorist groups defined by the US State Department has gone up over Obama's watch. We've seen terrorist attacks go up. We've seen attacks in the US, on the US territory go
up. There's no question.
Doesn't look like it's working from
where I'm sitting. There's no question the terrorist threat is evolving in a way that has been very difficult, and it's going to be very difficult for generations. No question. And the tools we have are getting more sophisticated, they're getting more precise, and they're getting more prevalent. So the question for President Obama is, how do you best use those tools? Because you could not use them. You could say, this is a great capability that we've got available, and we're not going to use it. And there are many instances, by the way, where he doesn't take the shot. He's got the target right there in the crosshairs, and for a variety of reasons, maybe it's civilian casualties.
Well, we don't know that, because one of the problems is there's been a huge lack of transparency from this administration.
More and more.
In fact, for the first half of the administration, they wouldn't even say the word drone in public.
That's different now, though, today, right? President Obama.
Yeah, but we're looking at his entire period. It was not transparent for a huge problem. And even today, there are different rules for the CIA.
It is very different today. It is, and part of what he has tried to do.
No group that's looking at this thinks the United States government is transparent on drone
strikes. Part of what he has tried to do as he is leaving office is be more transparent than any president has been over this program, for the precise reason, knowing that his successor is going to inherit all these tools.
Well, it's interesting you should say that, because you've written in your book that President Obama leaves the U.S. in a sound position on the global stage and leaves the next U.S. president a legacy that will allow him to, quote, operate sensibly and pragmatically. That's one view, Derek Sholley. Another view, to quote Anthony Romero from the American Civil Liberties Union, is that, quote, Obama's failure to rein in George W. Bush's national security policies hands Donald Trump a fully loaded weapon. He's right, isn't he? Drone strikes, NSA surveillance,
absolutely,
night raids, military tribunals. That's all now in Trump's hands, and that's on Obama.
Yeah, yeah. As
he's given that to, with his blessing.
I mean, he's given Donald Trump a U.S. military that's second to none. He's given Trump...
come on, this is beyond military. We're talking about specific practices.
No, look, he's given Donald Trump a special operations capability that is second to none in the world, that's got more capability and forces than ever before.
Which lacks transparency, which can allow him to kill civilians.
There's more transparency today than there's ever been over these kinds of activities. And the precise reason...
This is a U.S. president who killed a U.S. citizen by a drone strike.
Absolutely.
Something George Bush didn't do. Power is now going to go to Trump.
And people like yourself,
when you criticize Trump, he'll say, laugh at you and say, your president started all this.
President Trump is inheriting a lot of power for the United States. He's inheriting a U.S. economy that's doing pretty good.
That doesn't worry you.
It worries me a lot.
So that's on Obama, then. A lot of what Trump is going to do is going to be on Obama.
No.
He's going to use powers and precedents set up by a president.
That's
not illogical. How is it illogical?
It's illogical because it's basically say, because I don't know who my successor is going to be, I want to do the worst possible job I can so my successor doesn't inherit
a good
hand.
You do is you say, I may be some noble guy who doesn't take the shot, but the next guy will, and therefore I need to introduce rules and controls.
That's why he's been transparent.
He hasn't been transparent, Derek. Nobody agrees with the U.S. government's view of transparency in drones. Name to me a single group that's following drone strikes that thinks the U.S. government has been transparent. Name an academic, name a human rights group, name a U.N. official.
People want the U.S. to be more transparent, but I believe that the efforts President Obama, as he's been leaving office, including just recently, where he has released a detailed catalog of how these decisions get made, when they take drone strikes, when they don't, that's all in an effort, by the way, as to be as transparent as one can be. So the successor can be judged by how the Obama administration's done it.
Many of your critics, as you know, academics, human rights activists, etc., point out, for example, Obama's refusal to prosecute CIA torture under Bush now allows Donald Trump to bring it back much easier than he would have been able to had Obama put people behind bars.
Yeah, I think that actually it's going to be hard to bring back torture. There's other law that's come up since then, Supreme Court rulings including that will make it hard to bring it back. But again, we're going to judge the next president by the transparency Obama's leaving. Will Donald Trump be as transparent as Barack Obama on the use of drones? We'll see.
Derek Sholley, thanks for joining me on Upfront.
Thanks for having me. It's great to be here.
Thanks for being on.
Thanks.
One of the many, many criticisms of Donald Trump centers on his pledge to deport, to forcibly relocate all 11 million undocumented immigrants in the US in his first 2 years in office. But remember, this is how he defended that odious policy in the second presidential debate.
Nobody knows about it, nobody talks about it, but under Obama, millions of people have been moved out of this country, they've been deported.
Now, annoyingly, he's got a point, kind of. The truth is that the Obama administration has deported 2.5 million undocumented immigrants from the United States over two terms. 2.5 million, that's the highest number for any president ever. In fact, Obama is on course to have deported more people in his 8 years in office than all of the presidents of the 20th century combined. I guess that explains why his immigration enforcement budget in 2015 was a whopping $18 billion. That's $3 billion more than the budgets of all the other major domestic law enforcement agencies combined. Now, the Obama administration says the vast majority of the people it deports are people with criminal records, felons, threats to national security, which sounds reasonable, except that a study in 2014 found that two-thirds of deportation cases involved people who had committed minor infractions, including traffic violations, or had no criminal record at all. Take the case of Jose Marvin Martinez, who fled Honduras age 16 after his brother was murdered by suspected gang members. In 2014, he was deported back to his home country, and just 4 months later, he was shot to death by suspected gang members. Or how about Giovanni Miranda, who arrived in the United States as a child and was working legally when he had a minor traffic accident in 2009, when immigration officers discovered he'd been charged with a minor drug possession offense 7 years earlier, they sent him back to El Salvador, a homeland he'd never known. 3 years after his return, he was murdered by a gang in front of his wife and newborn child. These are just two out of tens of thousands of real-life stories, real-world tragedies, that many say will forever taint Obama's record on human rights and especially on immigration. So complain as much as you like about Trump's grotesque deportation plans, but the fact is that he's inheriting the most sophisticated and well-funded human expulsion machine in the history of the country from his Democratic predecessor. And shed as many tears as you like for outgoing President Barack Obama, but never forget that until Donald Trump came along, he was the deporter in chief. Barack Obama has called him his little brother. For the first 3 years of his presidency, from the inauguration to the raid that killed Osama bin Laden, Reggie Love stood at the US president's side in public and in private as his closest personal aide, his body man, his so-called chief of staff. So what was President Obama like when the cameras stopped rolling? And how did he cope with the pressures of the presidency, from crises at home to wars abroad? Reggie Love joins me now on Upfront. Thank you so much for taking time out.
Reggie, thank you for having me. Excited to be here today.
Having spent so much time at Obama's side with him in private, when the cameras are switched off, when journalists aren't watching, what quality about him that you think the public doesn't get, doesn't see, that you wish they'd seen more of over the past eight years?
That's a great question. And I think you, in the last few years, you got a lot of people who were sort of like critical of him because he was not like Bill Clinton. He was like, oh, he's aloof, or whatever the critics were saying. And, and I think there was an element that comparatively they didn't take into consideration was that, Barack Obama had two small daughters when he got to be the president of the United States. And one of the things that was really important to him was, he wanted to be a father who was there. He wanted to be a great husband and a great father.
You say aloofness, and people have talked about him being aloof. A lot of people have observed the president's, you might call it aloofness, some call it coolness, others say zen-like demeanor. His fans call him no drama Obama. How accurate is that description of him in your view? Is he someone who really never lost it, not even in private?
No, I think the guy's like very rational, right? But everyone has an irrational moment here and there. But I think in terms of how he makes decisions, I don't think he's one of these folks that, because I had a harsh response to something or harsh reaction to something, that my decision in dealing with that process is not also going to be harsh as well. It's really more, okay, let me process it, let me understand it, what are the challenges, what are the opportunities to make this, better than what it currently is today.
You were in the White House the day Osama bin Laden was killed in May 2011. What was it like? What was the president like at that time? I mean, just the night before, Obama was doing jokes at Donald Trump's expense at the White House Correspondents' Dinner, wasn't he? And the next day, this massive historic moment in his presidency happens.
I remember the day, and you know, it was a historical day, I think, for our country and for his presidency. I think one of the hardest parts of the job is sort of understanding that the decisions you make oftentimes have big impacts in terms of the effect on life, right? You are men and women who serve the United States to protect freedom and to protect our democracy. It's tough to have to make those types of decisions, and it's a challenge that you face throughout the entire presidency, whether it's Osama bin Laden, whether it's how you're dealing with things in Libya or Iran or whatever.
Well, a lot of people, a lot of liberals like Obama. They see him as a good guy, a decent guy who stood up for the little guy. He brought in health care, fought for equal pay, wanted a higher minimum wage. Yeah. But a lot of people at the same time on the left here in the US, in a lot of countries around the world, they look at Obama and they say, this is a guy who killed hundreds of civilians, including US citizens via drone strikes, who failed to prosecute CIA torturers, who helped put Chelsea Manning in solitary confinement, who had no problem with NSA surveillance until Edward Snowden came along and exposed it, etc., etc., etc. How do you deal with that disconnect between the personal, between the guy you knew personally, the good guy, family man, and the guy who was taking decisions, which often were very bad decisions, which led to bloodshed, which led to innocents being killed? How do you deal with that?
Look, I think, I respect the president, and I respect every decision he's ever made, and I think, no one else can sort of bear the load or the burden that it comes with making these decisions. I think every decision he made, I think he weighed carefully, and I think that at the point in time in which he made the decision, I don't doubt that that decision was something that he thought was going to be the best for moving our country forward. And to get it right 100% of the time, would just be, that's the hope, but it's not always the case.
You've written about how race was a reason the president leaned so much on you. You wrote in your book about your time in the White House, no matter what, he knew he could trust me. I was the only other brother working on the first floor of the West Wing in the bubble every day. Was there really just the two of you at that time? I mean, doesn't that reflect badly also on President Obama for not appointing more black people to senior positions in administration? He has Susan Rice now as a national security advisor. Yeah. But back then, if you're saying it was just you and him.
No, I mean, look, I said, so the point that I made was that in the West Wing, you had, a very small amount of spots, right? In terms of diversity throughout the entire administration, I think he was great on it, right? I think you had guys like Eric Holder, you had Lisa Jackson, you had Nancy Sutley, you had a huge amount of diversity throughout the entire Obama administration.
Do you think he did enough on diversity?
Look, I think you can always try to figure out how to be a little more diverse, right? Whether it's color, whether it's gender, whether it's, sexuality, I think you can always sort of work at it. And I think, as we progress, and as we become more accepting of these things, I think a lot of places are going to look more like Canada than they do, currently.
There are a lot of black community leaders, scholars, activists who are disappointed in the record of America's first black president. They point to the fact, for example, that the wealth gap between white America and black America actually went up on Obama's watch. How much does it weigh on his conscience as he does his own internal audit of the past 8 years? What's happened to black America?
I think he was especially concerned with people from Americans and black America. When you look at all the things that he and Secretary Holder had done to look at how local law enforcement agencies were assessing and processing their systems. When you look at what he did for healthcare, when you look at the Recovery Act as a whole and how you save, our economy from sort of the total brink, people who look like me, brown folks, they're the ones who would have been the most affected by a collapse in the economy.
I mean, how distraught is he that his legacy now, from Obamacare at home to the Iran deal abroad, could all be torn up?
It is a challenge. I don't think that Donald Trump will have the capabilities to dismantle it piece by piece. I think they will have a really good opportunity to make it what they think it should be. But to say that you're going to take away something that people have had for the last 6 years and turn it into nothing and give people nothing, I think it'll be very challenging.
Reggie Love, thanks for joining me on the show.
Matty, thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. That's our show. Up Front will be back next week.